Let's greet the writer and the director, Paul Weitz. Okay, this is the writer and the director of Grandma.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me.
And before we talk about the movie, just so you should know, you come from a very famous family. Susan Conan, Conner, was your mother.
Yeah, who was in...
Great actress.
She was in the movie Imitation of Life. She was
And John Weitz used to design my shirts and ties.
There you go.
John Weitz, the menswear designer. Okay, how did the story come to you? I read that it was in your head for a long time.
Yeah, there was some version of it in my head for a while, but I had done a film with Lily where she played Tina Fey's mother. She had a supporting role in the film Admission. And so I just spent some time with her, and then Admission came out, and I had a little bit of a panic attack because... you know, as a director, you get to be kind of a control freak on set. Hopefully in a pleasant, relatively pleasant way, hopefully. But when the film comes out, it's the absolute opposite experience. And so to sort of calm myself down, I went to this cafe and I started writing this. And it really did come to me. It's very odd because, but the only thing that really sticks with me is that I just spent time with Lily and I was hearing her voice as I wrote it. And it helped me write the whole thing. And it was just some perception I had about her, and not only how funny she was, but also how dedicated an actress she was. And in a way, how poignant I found her. Just that she was somebody who clearly had a healthy degree of cynicism about human nature and irony, but also she's very sweet and kind, certainly to me and to, for instance, the younger actress in this, Julia Garner. She's just a lovely person to be around, and I kind of joked that it was an excuse to get to spend a lot of time with her, which it was.
Okay, so you write the movie for Lily Tomlin, but she doesn't know you're doing it, but you call her for lunch and tell what happened.
Yeah, well, I didn't want to tell her I was writing it because I was worried she'd say, oh, thank you, but no thank you, please don't. So I just called her up and asked her to have lunch with me, and she sat down and she ordered a steak salad, and I thought to myself, "Why? Well, I hope she doesn't choke on her steak salad because I'm going to spring this on her." And I did spring it on her, and she kind of said, "Oh, well, that sounds very interesting. I'm kind of excited to read it." And now, when we were first talking about this, she sort of said, "Oh, I jumped in with both feet." But the reality is that I did have to woo her for a while.
Yeah. So. From the time you gave her the script, how long did it take to get the movie made?
It was a few months, and not really a ton of time. I mean, I did the movie very, for me, inexpensively, because I've done a lot of, this is the 10th film I directed, and they've all been studio films before this. But I did this for just under $600,000, which... happily, I had, from doing 9 other films, I have a lot of people's phone numbers. Like Marsha Gay Harden had done a film with me, and pretty much everybody, and Sam Elliott, who's lovely in it, had done a film with my brother called Golden Compass. I actually feel slightly guilty saying this. I sort of, it was financed fairly immediately, because it was so little money, essentially.
Right.
It was a very nice Greek gentleman who wanted to make a movie about a crazy grandma. I'm sure he didn't want to make this movie about a crazy grandma. He had something else in mind.
Where did you film it, and how many days did it take to film? Because I know it was a quick film.
Yeah, it was a 19-day shoot. And the thing was, I didn't write anything that didn't end up in there. I knew I couldn't afford to. And also, I was quite concerned about it. I'd seen films of a really small budget that I'd loved over the past couple of years. In fact, I'd watched them with an eye towards how do I do this. But I didn't know whether what I'd learned was going to translate. Happily, I'd kind of learned not to waste time. And I don't think there was a moment ever where the actors felt rushed. And Lily and I had a few months to go over the script. And everything from texture, such as she said to me when I first wrote the relationship between her and her deceased partner, that she's mourning which is to me sort of the core of the film, and there's obviously issues in the film, but to me, the emotional core of the film is how do you get over loss and move on and not feel guilty about that. But she said, oh, every time you describe them, they're sort of in some glowing terms, and if this is a real relationship, they would have fought with each other, been mean to each other, so I put in little things about that. And also, the little girl who punches her, Lily told me that her partner, Jane Wagner, they had been in Las Vegas for something, and it was late at night, and I think they were in a casino, and there's a little like six-year-old girl wandering around without her parents, and Jane went over to her and said, oh, sweetheart, where are your parents? And the little girl slugged her in the face. we were hanging out, and I told her, she told me this thing, and I said, may I please use that? Because I was having a really hard time trying to figure out how to make that scene distinct, because I'd seen movies like Juno and Citizen Ruth, etc., where there's a scene at a clinic, and I thought I'd kind of seen everything, but I hadn't seen that.
So did Lily change dialogue at all with you? Did she say, I don't think my character would say this at this point? Of course, you wrote it for her, so she...
I really tailored it for her. But I'll tell you something funny. When she first read it, she said, oh, does this character have to swear so much? She's meant to be kind of a literary person, and, you know, it really has an awful lot of blue language in this. And I said, well, okay, Lily, we can trim it back. And I actually did trim some stuff back. But then on the set, I would say the thing that was most often improvised was a lot of the swearing, which is truly Lily's off-the-cuff swearing.
She's terrific in this movie. Now, what's the history in the movie? Because now it's sort of rolling out again. I mean, you were at Telluride, right? In the beginning of the year?
Well, we were the closing night film at Sundance. The nice thing for me, at least, about doing the movie at the scale at which I did it was I didn't have any particular expectations. And honestly, you know, as I stood back there just now, I think I would have felt like I was smoking an opium pipe or something to think that I would, you know, do this film and have it shown to an audience like this. So it played its, first off, it got into Sundance, which was exciting, and then it was the closing night film, and oddly, before it was closing night, it was screened for distributors, and a few places happily wanted it, and it also was reviewed beforehand. It was terrifying, but it went really well at Sundance, and then, and it's been doing quite well, and I can, I know the opposite experience.
So, okay, but because she's getting a lot of Oscar buzz now, is that why the movie is coming out again to the theaters?
Well, I think she's awful good, and sorry, that's an understatement, honestly.
Well, she's in every scene.
She's in every scene. She's playing a different character for her. It's closer to her. When I showed her the film for the first time, she and Jane saw it along with Sam Elliott and his wife, who's the actress Catherine Ross, who's a lovely actress. They had him come to my office and watch it all together, and when they came downstairs, I was nervous, of course, and happily, they loved it, but Lily joked to me, she said, well, I should have thought of doing this 40 years ago, playing myself. And it's not exactly her, there's different experiences, but it's much closer to her than what she's done before. And I would imagine that would be kind of a scary thing to do. And she's lovely in it. I watched it earlier for the first time in a long time, and I was really, really impressed, which sounds like a stupid thing to say, but... because I was watching her when the other actors had the ball. and she's, there's not, to me, there's not a moment where she's out of it. She's absolutely, but you know, it's interesting. She's, one thinks of her in terms of her sort of characters that she does often, but she's a method actress. Like she uses stuff from her emotional life in every moment. I don't know, it was a joy.
The characters are so complex. How did you know, I'm about to ask this question, how do you know so much about lesbians? I couldn't write a movie about lesbians.
Okay, I think you sell yourself short, Bill.
Okay.
Well, keep listening. Look forward to seeing the movie a couple years from now. You know, I think the primary thing is not to condescend anybody, and just to, well, for one thing, if there was anything in here that Lily said was false, I wouldn't have put it in there. But for instance, you know, there is this relationship that her characters have with Sam Elliott, and if she had said to me, no, I don't believe that this woman would have ever been in a situation where she was with, had been with a man, would have been hard pressed to keep it in there, but it was really key to me, that line that, that she has, where she says, I always liked women, I just didn't like myself. So I had a very good first audience and critic. I don't know, I mean, beyond that, it's almost all women in the movie. You know, Sam has his say, but it's something I hadn't done before. But I'm a great admirer of Anton Chekhov. That's when I first decided I wanted to try to be a playwright, and I write plays as well. That was the person whose major plays sort of drew me to writing. And his plays have beautiful female characters and complicated ones. So I think in a weird way, as similar to making the film where I just didn't want to get in my own way, it was the same thing in the writing of it.
Now, the movie is about relationships, obviously family relationships and relationships with friends, but did you have any trouble writing about, because it's so much about the abortions, was that tough? Is that a tough sell to a studio?
Well, I didn't have to sell it to a studio. certainly would have been a tough sell to a studio. I feel their pain. Beyond that, I didn't have to do stupid exposition. When you do a research screening, they hand out cards, and one of the major questions is there anything you didn't understand? And the sort of the idea that having no ambiguity somehow makes something more enjoyable is a bit of a it's a lodestone around your neck when you're making a regular studio film. In terms of that, to me, the political aspect of this film is simply that it doesn't devalue people's individualism, and that I'm very interested in the overlap between societal issues and political issues and the personal. And whether it be a movie like Kramer versus Kramer, or earlier Guest Who's Coming to Dinner, in a way The Graduate, something that is about something that's in the air with our society, but is really sucks you in because of the emotions of the characters, is what I'm kind of interested in. To me, that is the overall political statement, which is to try not to devalue people.
Okay, if any of you have questions, I'll come out there in a minute. But at the end of the film, after the girl has the abortion, it seems like that brings the family together, like this important event. Is that one of the messages I'm supposed to get, that all of a sudden, I think Lily Tomlin's gonna get closer again to her daughter, and the grandmother obviously is close with the granddaughter, and it's gonna be a family unit?
Yeah, well, the to me, a dumbing down of a theme that I was thinking of was the three words, get over it. And to me, one of my favorite things in the movie that I was very happy to be watching, because as a director you get to be the first audience, was that little scene where Lily and Marsha are sitting in the waiting room, and there's a little bit of silence in it, and then Marsha says, kids. Marsha's character, no matter what she thinks, no matter how angry she is at her daughter, she shows up. And in a way, Lily shows up, Lily's character shows up emotionally for her granddaughter. And I do think that that is some aspect, obviously, of getting over loss in some way, is being needed by somebody and having some quest where you have to come through for somebody. So, it's really funny because the one thing in terms of the abortion issue I didn't want to do was it was simply that when I sat down to write up the character, the 18-year-old showed up and she was pregnant and she had scheduled an abortion. And from that point on, I just didn't want to be fake to these characters. That was about it. This is how these characters were acting. So I wasn't particularly trying to make any point, honestly.
Okay, you wrote it, you directed it. Do you enjoy writing it more or directing more?
Well, I like writing to the extent that you, for a little time, get to live in a magical, well, a fantasy world, like you're playing with dolls as a kid. And the characters are occurring to you. Like, I didn't know that, honestly, when I was first writing, I didn't know that Lily's character had an abortion and that it had been Sam Elliott's character's kid.
Right.
She just showed up at that house, and he was saying very menacing stuff, like, when you smile, you're showing your skeleton. It was almost like a Pinter play to me. But then it sort of started coming together. But they're great antidotes to each other, writing and directing, I find. Because as a director, you have to make decisions very rapidly, and you have to be okay with some of the decisions being maybe the wrong decision and trust that you can fix it down the line. To me, that's a great thing because I have a really hard time deciding what to order for lunch.
Yeah. Now, you work with your brother a lot on a couple of movies, like American Pie, and a couple of, About a Boy. What's it like working with your brother?
It was really great, lovely. He's a wonderful person, and happily, he's directs on his own as well. He did a film called A Better Life, which I thought was a lovely film. I went to school in America. Our dad had gone to school in Britain, and my brother went to school in Britain as well. And there's an affectation in Britain that you never appear to really like your job, I think. It's just not gentlemanly. And so he would do stuff like we'd be on the way to the set in the morning, or no, we'd come home from the set, and he'd say, God, I don't know if I ever want to direct again. And I'd say, well, okay, but we're doing it at 7 a.m. tomorrow, so I'll hide that.
Okay, who has questions?
The runtime is 78.
Wait. I do feel down to you.
Great movie, thank you.
Thank you so much.
The runtime is 78 minutes. I'm wondering if you wrote it that length or if it just made sense to have it that length when you were editing.
I didn't write much more than that. That was also a collective. I knew I was going to have a limited amount of time. Honestly, too, I felt that I felt that some of my storytelling in the films I've done in the past maybe was a little overcomplicated, and I really wanted a very, very simple plot line, which I hoped would allow the characters to become very complicated. So that was just it. I didn't want any wasted energy, essentially.
I just have a comment. You were asked a question about how could you write about lesbians? What do you know about lesbians? A good writer doesn't have to actually experience it. What do you know about abortions? You never had one, but you can still write about it. I just think that you did a great job in the writing. It was so great that you were able to picture people's or depict people's emotions and feelings so beautifully.
I'm very grateful. Thank you, Mom. Thank you so much.
Who's got a question?
Yes, I have a question, and I think I can speak for most of the patrons here. The storyline, phenomenal. The acting was fantastic. The only question I have, and I think I can speak for everyone here, when are you going to do a sequel?
Thank you. You mean the grandpa movie with Sam Elliott? I want him to find love. Yeah. Thank you.
I don't have a question. I have a compliment. But it is a question. What made you think in terms of doing it all in one day? I mean, it was amazing that it was all in one day, and yet there wasn't a minute in there that you felt bored by what was going on in this one day.
Thank you very much. I wanted a ticking clock. I felt like I'd seen a Norwegian movie called Oslo, August 31st, which is pretty much one day in the life of a recovering addict who's—it's a very different kind of movie. A recovering addict who's getting out and going to do a job interview, and you're seeing whether or not he's going to relapse or not. And it was a really beautiful film. That was kind of sticking in my head. I just actually felt like some constraints were going to be good for me. And thank you very much.
Where'd you film the movie?
I filmed it all around Los Angeles. I filmed it at my house. I filmed it at my two scenes at my office, the office I share with my brother. Marcia Gay Harden, when she's on the treadmill desk, that's in her office, and that's Chris's, my brother's, treadmill desk. I walked up there one day and I looked at it and I called Marcia and I said, hey, how would you feel about doing the first part of the scene on a treadmill desk? And she said, oh, that'd be a hoop. Marcia, she's formidable dramatic actress, but the moment in there that rings truest to me about her is there's a little moment, very fast, where she gets off the treadmill desk and she's got a towel and she wipes her underarms before going to the movie, into a meeting, and that's very much what she's like. Sorry, not disgusting, I mean, but she's got a good sense of humor. And then the scene in the clinic where the doctor is examining Lily and shining a light in her eyes was in another room in my office.
Because it was a low budget, I've learned from these Q&As, did you steal some scenes in the streets of LA and stuff?
Yes. I was kind of shocked with, you know, we actually had a police, we had a police person for a couple of the scenes, the driving scenes, basically. And the scene where the car breaks down. That was Lily's car, by the way, her actual car. Yeah. Yeah. I called her up one day and I was like, Lily, I'm going to look at some cars that Elle might drive. I'd like you to give your opinion about them. And she said, well, why don't you come over here? I've got a car in the garage. That car was a car which she's had, I think it's a 50s car, but she's had it since the 70s. And she was kind of forbidden to drive it by Jane. Because I know this because I drove it a little bit. You could press down the brake, but it's not going to stop until it wants to. It's a slightly terrifying car, but Lily actually has the touch with it. So,
because of your reputation, once you had Lily Tomlin, was it easy to get all the other actors?
Yeah, everybody said yes. It was really exciting, and I'm sure a large part of that was just to do this particular movie with Lily. Everybody.
Sam Elliott was terrific.
Yeah, Sam was great. He was so sweet. He was really excited, I think, to do, I think it was a slightly different character for him, in that he kind of gets quite raw in it. And when I showed up to shoot that scene, I was quite early, and there was a pickup truck outside parked down the road. And I said, oh, one of the crew members is here kind of early, too. And it was Sam, sitting there waiting to go to work.
That's great.
Yeah, it was really neat.
You happy with the movie? I mean, when you watched the movie tonight, that's the movie that you envisioned when you wrote it?
Yeah, it's better than I envisioned, certainly, because the actors bring so much to it. I'm really happy with it, and I'm trying to allow myself to take pleasure in that. Because, yeah, it doesn't always happen.
What's next for Paul Weitz? What are you working on?
I do a show called Mozart in the Jungle, which is set in the classical music world, which is on Amazon. It's a completely different tone. It's like a Ernst Lubitsch type thing. So I'm doing that, and I'm just writing. Some stuff.
Do you like writing for TV?
It's only 10 episodes, and they put them all out together. So I do like this one, yeah, because there's beautiful music in it. It's set at a symphony or in a symphony orchestra. So I'm learning a lot.
Is writing a movie or writing anything, because now I have to write a movie about, you know, gay guys. Is it lonely? Or is it some, I mean, do you wake up at a certain time and say, you know, give yourself hours and say, you know, 8 o'clock in the morning, I'm gonna sit down and do this?
I've been doing it a long time. And to me, it's just a mental exercise. It's a mental exercise and an exercise in humility, as is any, I think, great endeavor. It's not lonely, no. Okay. When it's going well, you have these characters around you. When you're forcing it, it's awful. But
do you write longhand or on the computer?
With stuff like this, I like to write it longhand because there's always a temptation on a computer to go back and edit. And to me, it's better to get it out there.
Okay, anybody else have questions?
That was the finest performance I've ever seen by Sam Elliott. As the director, how much did you affect that?
The main thing for me was to get out of the way, honestly. I was prepared. That's another lovely thing about Sam. When I first wrote it, the character had a pigtail in the script, or a ponytail, and not pigtail. Pigtails are really silly. ponytail. And Sam called me up. He said, I know you don't have any money. I shouldn't do my Sam Elliott voice. He said, I know you don't have any money, and I'm going to go and buy myself a wig. I got a good wig maker, and I don't want to put this on you. And I said, Sam, I don't care if the character has a ponytail, because he happened to have short hair at the time and then had shaved his mustache. It was interesting that once they got into the stuff where they were shouting at each other, and he got quite emotional, I came up to him with a note, and he looked at me as I walked up, and he said, I know you want me to pull it back, like tone it down. And I said, no, not at all. I don't remember actually what my note was, but I thought that was really interesting that clearly you've been given that note before. So really, a lot of it is about having the confidence to get out of the way of the actor.
Anybody else? Oops.
Okay. Anybody else?
Hi, great film.
Thank you.
Just want to know where you will be speaking next.
I'm speaking right outside here on Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays. Thank you. I don't know. I hope, I'm sure. I don't have to respond. Thank you.